worship him, say amen.
Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you. Welcome this morning to First United Methodist Church. We are thankful that you have chosen today to worship with us. I would invite you, if you will, to stand to your feet. Turn to page 368 in your hymnal. The word should also be on the screen as well. Let's sing all four verses. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness.
Please remain standing as we please remain standing as we affirm our faith this morning with the Chalcedonian Creed. We then, following the Holy Fathers, all with one consent, teach men to confess one and the same Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, the same perfect in Godhead, and also perfect in manhood, truly God and truly man, of a reasonable soul and body, consubstantial with the Father according to the Godhead, and consubstantial with us according to the manhood, in all things like unto us, without sin, begotten before all ages of the Father, according to the Godhead, and in these latter days for us and for our salvation, born of the Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, according to the manhood, one and the same Christ, Son, Lord, only begotten, to be acknowledged in two natures, unconfusedly, unchangeably, indivisibly, inseparably, the distinction of natures being by no means taken away by the union, rather the property of each nature being preserved and concurring in one person and one substance, not parted or divided into two persons, but one and the same Son, and only begotten, God the Word, the Lord Jesus Christ, as the prophets from the beginning have declared concerning him, and the Lord Jesus Christ himself has taught us, and the creed of the Holy Fathers has handed down to us. You may be seated. And would the children please come forward, the little ones.
Today. Are you happy to be here? I'm excited to see your bright, shining faces. Tell me, do any of you, good morning, welcome, do any of you know how to tell time? You do? That's awesome. So what do we use to tell time with? A clock. What else? Maybe a watch? A digital clock would be great. Adults sometimes use their cell phones to tell time on. How do we know what time of year it is? How do we know when the seasons are changing? Maybe weather. Very good. This time of year, it's very hot, and people are taking vacations and going to the beach, so that means it's summer, right? Well, pretty soon we're going to be heading into fall, and we know that because we're already talking about back to school. We're seeing back to school lists being posted. People are talking about buying special backpacks and going back to school shopping. And you know, this week I was thinking about all the things I've got to do before back to school. Later this week, I'm going to be headed to Dallas for work for a conference. And when I get back, I've got to renew my CPR because I have to have that for school. I've got all this stuff I've got to get ready for my classroom, and my room is totally empty right now because we did some remodeling at my school, and so I've got to put all my stuff back in my room and get it all clean and ready to go for new students. And then, like, right after that, school starts. We start school on August the 8th at my school. So I was thinking about that, and I thought, you know what, God, it's just too fast. Summer's just gone by too fast. So I thought, you know what? I need 2 more weeks of summer. So I was thinking, I really wish God would just do that. Just give me 2 more weeks of summer and I'd be okay. But you know, it doesn't work like that, does it? Because it's not all about me. There might be, unbelievably, there might be other people out there that are ready to move on to back to school or move on to fall. I don't see that, but there might be people out there that need more time, so it's not all about me. Well, you know, the Bible says there's a time in Ecclesiastes, there's a time for everything, and there's a season for every activity. So God works on his own timing. He doesn't work on our timing. So maybe if we're not ready for back to school, or we're praying about something and it doesn't happen just immediately, God works on his own timing. And what we need to know is that God has a plan. He has our whole life and our whole day and our whole week and our whole month mapped out for us. And so we need, as part of our faith journey, to trust in God's timing. Do you think we can do that? Let's have a prayer. Dear God, we know that we don't see the big picture that you do. We need to trust in your timing and your season for all the activities of our life. Help us to trust in you and in our faith journey, know that whatever we're praying for, wishing for, hoping for, that it's all in your timing. Help us to be patient and to trust in your wisdom and your guidance. I pray for these precious children and the families that have brought them here to church today, and I ask that you guide us and direct us as we go throughout this week. Be with our church as we make big decisions. Be with the families who are having to pray about that and discern with us what your will is. And we ask all these things in your name. Amen.
I would invite you, if you will, to stand again, if you're able. Now listen, if you're not able, it's okay. You know, it's that call is always up to you. But if you are able, I would invite you to stand and join us as we sing all five verses of the Church's One Foundation on page 545. And y'all know me, I'm a good Methodist. We're going to sing all five verses. You may be seated. If you've got a prayer request on your heart this morning, would you just lift your hand? You don't have to announce it. The Lord sees it. Let's pray together. Precious Lord, we are blessed today to come into your house. We are blessed to be your children. We are blessed to come and worship you. And Lord, we know that when we are gathered together in your name, that it's not about us, but it's about you. And that you have promised to dwell in our midst. And so we celebrate the fact today that we are not in this room by ourselves, but that your Holy Spirit is gathered with us, inside of us, moving around us. And we pray, Lord, that you would penetrate our hearts and our minds so that we might be wholly yours, that we might completely and totally belong to you. Lord, all of us today, we gather in awe of you. We gather because we love you, and we gather, Lord, because we need you, and our hearts are heavy. We have struggles, we have difficulties, we have temptation, we have all of the things that come against us in this world. But Lord, we believe that greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And so, Lord, we come trusting you. Be with us now. Use us for the building of your kingdom. And Lord, as we join together in the model prayer this morning, the Lord's Prayer, I pray that we would hear it. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let me invite you, just like I did last week, let's be in prayer for Mary Jo Kirkpatrick and her family. Her dad was in an accident. Billy, is everything about the same? He's hanging in there. But when you're 91, 92 years old and you get in an accident and you have ribs broken and other things that are wrong, they just need a lot of prayer, and he needs a lot of prayer. So we want to remember them. And I also would invite you, if you will, to continue to remember Miss Shirley and her family in your prayers. Mr. Mike has passed away, and that memorial service will be here this coming Saturday at 10:30. And so please remember that family, and we're so thankful for all of the service and Miss Shirley's dedication to this church. She's a very integral part of our church. So with that being said, ushers, if you will come forward, we will worship God through our giving. Thank you.
As a younger person, unfortunately, I was introduced to that song through the movie, Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? So every time they sing it, I'm like, it's the Soggy Bottom Boys in the background.
Next time we'll wear beards.
We do have a youth witness moment this morning. I got some of our students who went on the M28 youth trip to come up and just tell a little bit about their time. Alex, Sam, if y'all want to make your way up here, and rock, paper, scissors on who goes first. But they're going to share a little bit about their time at camp and how much they enjoyed it. So.
Yay, I get to go first. So I was going to talk about two different things that we did. So my favorite part of the whole entire time was the last day we went up there and we screamed, "Praise the Lord," across the mountain ranges, and it bounced back and forth. And I thought that was like really cool and powerful. And then my other favorite thing was the tubing that we did. And it was kind of like a lazy river, and you get in this little like tube thing and you sit there and go down, and there's a bunch of rocks, and like we kept getting stuck. And it was funny, and you had to rock back and forth and get unstuck. But it was still fun, so that's all I have to say.
Mine's going to be a little different than that. the worship there was unbelievable. Every time we worshiped, you could just feel the Holy Spirit moving in the room, and it really made me question my foundation and my faith, and it stirred something in me. So I'm glad I got to go.
We had some more that we were going to get up here. Unfortunately, they couldn't make it this morning. Maggie sends her love from Jamaica. You know, I know, right? So, please stand for our gospel reading this morning, coming from the book of Matthew 7, verses 24 through 29. Matthew 7, verses 24 through 29. Hear these words. "Everyone then who hears these words of mine and acts on them will be like a wise man who built his house on rock. The rain fell, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not act on them will be like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain fell and the floods came and the winds blew and beat against that house and it fell, and great was its fall. Now when Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as their scribes." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. So this particular verse is also the verse that we discussed when we went to M28 in North Carolina. It was kind of the overarching theme of the weekend, and I wanted to give you some of the things that really stood out to me about this weekend and made me think some. There was a skit that the counselors had come up with, and one counselor kind of played the main character. He played Christian man number one. And he was sitting down, and he had all these friends that would come and talk to him. One of these friends would come up and talk to him and say, "Well, listen, buddy, I know you're a Christian, but my friend over there, they're going to parties a lot. They're getting kind of heavy into the alcohol. Like, what do I do? Where do I go from here?" And he would look at him and say, "Well, I'm a Christian. I'll pray for you." And they would be like, okay, is there any other advice that you can give me? Well, I'm a Christian. I'll pray for you. And then they would walk off. And then another person would come. And they would say, hey, aren't you that Christian? And he said, yes, I am a Christian. And they say, brother, I've been feeling kind of down. I've been feeling kind of depressed. I've been feeling, you know, my thoughts are not all there. Brother, do you have any advice for me? Well, he said, I'm a Christian. I can pray for you. And then they'd walk off. And then it would be situation after situation where they came to talk to this boy who was a Christian. And the only things he could say were, I'm a Christian, I will pray for you. There was nothing deeper than that. There was nothing underneath him. There was no, let me give you this scripture, let me pray for you right now. It was, oh, I'll pray for you, I'm a Christian. And that was it. That was the extent of the depth of his faith. That's what he knew how to say. And I can tell you, I have been there at some points in my life where I had no clue what to say, and I just said, I will pray for you. I was guilty of what this skit was showing me. And maybe some of y'all can relate to that as well, where you just don't know the words, and I'm a Christian, I'll pray for you. And all of a sudden, the foundation underneath you feels a little bit unsturdy. The second thing that stood out to me in this camp was in small groups. And I will say that the leader's small group was kind of small, but we connected with some of the people there. And there was an older gentleman who was ministering to some of the younger men in his group, and he was a former Navy man. And we were talking about this idea of having a foundation underneath us, having a firm foundation like what the scripture we read says. And he said, you know what? Not only is it important to have a foundation, we sometimes really need to check our foundation. And not just check it occasionally or maybe in a couple of months. We need to check the foundation regularly. What are we standing on regularly? What are we examining in our spiritual lives regularly? Are we making sure that there are no cracks, no rust? Are the windows able to open? I kind of Googled how to inspect a foundation because I have never done this. And so some of the things that they point out are like, walk around the perimeter of your home. Check for cracks. Look for areas that bulge or lean, which can indicate uneven load on the foundation. Both the foundation walls and home walls should be flush and level. Walk the interior perimeter of your home. Similar to the exterior, you should inspect the interior walls of the home. Any cracks or separation may indicate issues with the foundation. Along with the walls, check all doors and windows. They should all open smoothly and close without difficulty. If your home has a crawl space, it is important to inspect the area. Excessive and prolonged moisture is one of the leading causes of foundation problems. There's a little checklist right here, and it's a process to check your foundation. There are steps you go through to check your foundation. In our spiritual lives, we can't just look at this big picture and say it's okay. We have to go deeper than the surface level. We have to really understand, do we know our scripture? Have we been with the Lord in prayer? Have we loved our neighbor? This boy, all he could say was, I'm a Christian, I'll pray for you. That's surface level. It was showing the youth, it was surface level. Have we gotten a firm foundation in our faith? Have we inspected it recently? Maybe we haven't. Maybe we haven't looked underneath what we've built in a while because we're so used to the same Sunday service. Have we said in our lives, have I spent time with the Lord this week? The scripture today, Jesus is talking to his disciples at the tail end of the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus had just got done with one of the most important sermons. And he says, if you do not put this into practice, then you're not doing it right. Both men in this parable hear what Jesus said. Both men, meaning the one that built on the rock and the one that built on the sand, they both heard what Jesus said. They hear, but only one does. Only one was a doer of God's word. He said, I have heard you, and now I am going to go and be the hands and feet. Now I am going to go and build on a firm foundation. The other one did not. And that makes me think of church services on Sundays. We can hear Wesley preach. You can hear me preach. But unless you hear and then go out into the world, unless God has touched you on Sunday morning, moved you in some way on Sunday morning, has driven you to do something, then we are being just hearers. We are not being doers. Times are changing in our world and in our church, and we need to inspect our foundation. Is what we have built on, is what we have built scripturally based? Have we built on the scriptures? Are we leaning on the God-breathed book of life? Are we seeking scripture for our advice? Is God the number one person we go to? Are we emphasizing the importance of this faith, of this book to our youth, to our children? Love, joy, peace, kindness, goodness are great to say, but are we doing those things for our neighbors? Our next door neighbor, our neighbor without a home. Our foundation is sand unless we are doers of the Word of God. And when Jesus spoke this, he did so at the very tail end as one with authority. Jesus is the contractor who are building this thing for us. He is trying to make sure that his disciples had a firm foundation, a firm grasp on who he and who God is. Jesus is God's son. And he is the ultimate authority we should listen to and follow his example and his words. And if I could give you any advice from this parable today, it's this. Expect storms. Know they're going to hit you. The Bible does not say that your life will be hunky-dory, and I'm very sorry about that. I wish it did. But expect storms. Expect turbulence, expect temptation, expect the water to rise. Our broken world will never, ever, ever fulfill our hearts. It won't. So expect the storms. Know that they will come for you. War, jealousy, anger, envy, storms of all kinds will test us. Everyone's storm looks a little different. Financial difficulty, lust, alcohol. These things are going to test your foundation. And my prayer this morning is that you built on the rock. My prayer is that you've built with Jesus as your cornerstone. My prayer is that today, if you feel like you've built on sand, you're ready to move to firmer ground. You're ready to build a foundation on the Word of God. You're ready to build a foundation with Jesus leading the way. You're ready to build a firm foundation so that way we can pass this down and love our neighbor and know that we are standing firm on God's righteousness and His grace. That is the foundation we need to be standing on. This book, this Word, is God-breathed. May we put it as our cornerstone today and every day. In every conversation we will have today in this church, Christ will be the cornerstone. Amen. Amen. Our closing hymn is Precious Lord, Take My Hand, found on page 474, verses 1 through 3.
Oh, so I let him do it. Lord of mercy, preach hard as I did. What he said is the God, hold on there, Doc. Hold on just a second on that introduction, on that hymn. Always glad to have Dr. Cantek with us. She's a marvelous musician and a wonderful lady, best I can tell. I've only been around her a few times, but it's all been positive every time. He shared the truth with us this morning. The world is depending on you to have a faith that is deeper than, I'm a Christian and I'll pray for you. Y'all understand that our world is falling apart all around us. And if the calling of the church is just to be an extension of the country club, we're not any good at it. But if the calling of the church is to offer people a life-changing relationship with Jesus Christ, a God that can invade your heart and change every aspect of you, then brothers and sisters, we can succeed at that. And that's what our world needs. Our world is hungering for a group of people at First Methodist Church in Amory, Mississippi, to be so excited and passionate about Jesus that it's bubbling out of them. So now I'm going to tell you what. That's a powerful word, brother. We're going to take a few minutes. I know most of y'all want to get on to that meeting, but I think prayer, coating everything with prayer, is always the way to go. So we're going to sing that Precious Lord, Take My Hand. You can stand up. The altar's open if you're here for the first time. And for today, you say, man, I heard his sermon, and I need that. I need to build my life on something that is solid. Then come and get you some Jesus today. Don't go home without him. Let him in. Give him control. Be the best thing you ever done. If you just want to pray about inspecting, maybe you're like me and you heard the message today and you think, I need to inspect that foundation a little bit closer, because every now and again I get some termites on mine and we have to get them off. The altar's open. I'll be happy to pray with you if you need me to. Let's stand and sing, Precious Lord, Take My Hand, because I don't want to walk without him holding my hand.
I am tired, I am weak.
Amen. Whew, I love that song. Thank you, Jesus. All right, y'all be seated just for a moment, and I'll let you remain in this position. A few announcements to make. We will have the blessing of the backpack on Sunday, August the 7th. So before worship on that Sunday, if you would bring your child's backpack in and lay them on the kneeling rail up here, we're going to have a special prayer for our children and our teachers and all of our school employees. A blessing of the new school year, and always an important day. And I'm going to tell you what, we can't pray.